Howdy, how's it going? My name's Davy Chappie, and today we will be going over the new features of the first third of subclasses from Tasha's Guide to Everything. I'm going to be going over the subclasses, as well as the optional new features and traits of the Barbarian, the Bard, the Cleric, and the Druid, with the other classes detailed in my Parts 2 and 3 videos. Now, this video is already crunched for time, so if a subclass from this book originally appeared in a different splat book, then I'm not going to cover it again. I'll just let you know where you can hear about it, so that you can still get all your Chappie propaganda. I'm also not going to be talking about the Artificer. That class is getting its own separate Redux video sometime in the future, including the new subclass and features. As always, keep in mind that the majority of this video is just my opinion, so if you feel like the new Druid subclass is too hot to handle, feel free to play your games however you like. But with that out of the way, let's begin. So to start things off, the resident Himbo gets new features that give it more skill proficiency so that it isn't so boring, and a bonus action pounce so that it can nuzzle on things once it flies into a rage. Both of these features seem perfectly fine by me, and I don't see a reason not to add them to your game. As far as subclasses go, the Barbarian gets two, the Path of the Beast and the Path of Wild Magic. The Path of the Beast brings out your muscle-bound fursona when you rage, giving you natural bite, claw, and tail weapons that all have an additional feature so that they're not pointless to use. You also start to Darwinize and gain your own climbing, swimming, and jumping speed. You catch rabies and decide, you know what, screw it, I'll work with it, and then start spreading your virus around like an anti-masker, infecting your enemies, and then eventually even your friends, as your primal fury extends to your allies and throws everybody into a power frenzy. The Barbarian has never been the most adaptable class in the world. After all, its entire game plan is get mad and seek violence, and this subclass doesn't really change that, but the first two features do give options for how you want to carry that violence out, and since you swap between those options very frequently, you'll either pick up a feature that you like and stick with it, or you'll be a bit less bored when punching stuff. If you want options though, then you might want to take a look at the Path of Wild Magic, which, like the Sorcerer before it, relies on a gimmicky wild magic table to solve for its fun value, and it is the closest thing to casting a Barbarian will reasonably see. Like I said, when you go into a rage, you'll roll on a wild magic table that will add an additional benefit to your thickness, such as exploding flumps, tentacles, radiant chest beams, and a gay aura of homoerotic protection. You can also pop a vein to detect magic, give people spell slots back, or help them with ability checks using the cursed unholy power of the D3 dice. You can reroll your wild magic when you get hit by something, and you can eventually roll twice and pick your favorite, both of which will help you get the magical effect that you want. Realistically, this subclass is for people who want to dick around with their combat, because it's not until level 10 they actually get something that will help you narrow down a specific wild magic ability, and your whole playstyle could potentially be reshaped by your dice roll, meaning if you like randomness and like keeping things exciting and unknown, then this is the choice for you. Next up, my favorite class was given some quality of life improvements via new spells, the option to swap its expertise and cantrips every few levels, and a buff to Bardic Inspiration so that it buffs healing or damage. I'm not personally on the train that Bardic Inspiration is underpowered, but it's nice to give more variation to what is essentially the class's staple gimmick. For subclasses, the Bard is given the Colleges of Creation and Eloquence, but since the College of Eloquence comes from the Mythic Odysseys of Theros, I'll just direct you to that video to save some time. The Creation Bard, however, takes the power of song, speech, and presentation to a new level by gaining the godlike ability to create things, proving once and for all that bards are the supreme master of the galaxy. Specifically, the College of Creation relies on manifesting objects into the world and animating others to fight in times of need, with the main gimmicks being giving their bardic inspiration its own inspiration called the Mote of Potential, which can be spent to augment abilities just like the bardic inspiration, but with a more dramatic bent, and also the ability to will items of increasingly wealthy value into the world just through the power of speech alone. Oh, you're worried about crashing the economy? Well, the person who made this isn't. For real though, you can just force them to look obviously fake, or better yet, tell your player not to ruin the game for you. Furthermore, you can bring these items to life with your own personal stat block that largely doesn't care about the item size, and eventually you can bring forth a group of things to life, flaunting in the face of God and establishing your own animated object mafia. Mommy likes her pearls, and her pearls been hearing you want to skip town. Honestly though, if you've been interested in a necromantic bard, this might be the best place for it. Skeletons are objects, so you can technically animate them, and you can flavor the Motes of Potential as, like, ghosts or something. I don't know, there's ideas here. As for the next class, the Cleric gets new spells, which will be a feature in all of the spellcasting classes, so I'm gonna stop saying it. Just assume that every caster gets cool new Tasha spells. And a bunch of new features. First, their Channel Divinity gets a universal new option where you can spend it to regain a spell slot. Not necessarily powerful, but super useful when you need it. They can also swap out their cantrips every few levels, and they get a replacement for their Divine Strike or Potent Spellcaster features, which adds a d8 to both their weapon attacks and cantrips. I'm not sure exactly why this feature was created, but my best guess is so that you aren't beholden to either magic or melee if you happen to be a subclass that prioritizes one of them. And speaking of subclasses, the Cleric is given a total of 3 new ones, the Peace Domain, the Twilight Domain, and the Order Domain, which is a carryover from Ravnica, so you can go watch that video if you want a rundown. The Peace Domain is similar in concept to the Love Domain of Unearthed Arcana's past, and it prioritizes defending your allies and keeping them alive in ways beyond just healing them like a normal support cleric. The The main ability for the Peace Cleric is that in addition to a new proficiency, the cleric gains the ability to tether a few people together in an undefined platonic bond, applying a permanent guidance to the tethered fellows and providing them with more benefits as the cleric levels up, like being able to tether more people. The cleric also gains a new channel divinity that lets them glide around, avoiding attacks and healing people that they get near. As their bond of friendship grows stronger, tethered allies can switch places with each other to trade out who takes damage. The cleric gets potent spellcasting, and the tether eventually gets strong enough to double the range that the teammates can get from each other, and protect them from damage whenever they protect each other. It's the perfect anime teamwork class, and it proves definitively that friendship is magic. Anyway, the other archetype is the Domain of Twilight, and I'm gonna go as long as I can without making a Stephanie Meyer joke because she gets royalties whenever I do. The Twilight Domain specializes in darkness, but they didn't want to call it the Domain of Darkness because that would be way too edgy, so instead it is the Twilight Domain that gets to see in the dark from up to 300 feet away and share that dark vision with its friends. This dark vision range is insanity and breaks the game so hard without even trying because it means that in dungeons or out during nighttime, you will always have range on whoever you're fighting unless you're physically prevented from being far away every time you fight in darkness. No one should be able to out-darkness the drow, but I digress. The other Twilight powers include giving advantage on initiative to your friends, using your channel divinity to create a bubble that follows you and grants temporary HP to you and your friends every turn for a minute, the power to fly so long as you're in dim light or darkness, divine strike because cleric, and your capstone gives your bubble boys half cover. I don't have to think for 2 seconds about this subclass, it is not allowed in my games. This thing is grossly overpowered. Constant temp HP at level 2, nonsense dark vision, constant uninterrupted flight at level 6. Okay, that one's a little more manageable. Any one of these things would get a no from me, but altogether, the Twilight Domain gets a fuck no. There, that's my one allotted swear word per YouTube's algorithm. And finally, we come to the Druid, who, in line with the other classes, gets a bunch of quality of life changes, like cantrip versatility and spells. But most importantly, the Druid gets a buff to their wild shape so that instead of transforming themselves into an animal, they can instead summon an animal via the Find Familiar spell. Neat. As for subclasses, like the Cleric, the Druid gets two new ones and a reprint from Ravnica called the Circle of Spores. The first new subclass is the Circle of Stars, a Druid that looked up and was like, yeah, you know what, screw it, I'll worship that now, I guess. This circle's main gimmick is guiding people towards their goals, which is why every star druid builds their own star chart that shoots out guidance and guiding bolt every once in a while. You can also forego the traditional wild shape to instead transform into a constellation, making you glowy and giving you more abilities based on whether your stars are from an archer, a chalice, or a dragon. Later on, whenever you wake up, you can consult the stars on whether it's going to be a good or bad day, and then you project your astrology readings onto other people to make their days better or worse. As you keep going, your constellation form gets a boost, and it eventually becomes partially incorporeal so that people can't hurt you as easily while you're doing the rave. As far as druids go, the Circle of Stars is sort of a grab bag of weird ideas that follow a vague formula of representing the glowy things in the sky. But the secret to the subclass is now you have the perfect opportunity to flavor it as your own anime pop star diva druid. So get out there and desu some things. I don't know, I don't speak Japanese. Anyway, the last subclass of this video is actually one that I was pretty hyped for. Fire druids have always been my thing, so the Circle of Wildfire does a pretty good job of facilitating my deeply repressed desire for pyromania. You start out by getting some new fire-themed spells like Burning Hands and Scorching Ray, but weirdly, not Fireball. I can't imagine why, I don't think we really needed plant growth. Actually, why don't druids have plant growth? Regardless, in addition to spells, the other main feature of the druid is their animal companion, the Wildfire Spirit, an elemental creature of pure fire that helps you out in fights and also does not provide a light source, despite literally just being fire. As you grow to get further on the fire department's shit list, your Wildfire Spirit will empower your healing and fire-based spells, you can burn the souls of your slain victims to heal your friends or otherwise continue your destructive rampage, and your Wildfire Spirit will eventually grow so attached to you that when it sees you about to fall in battle, it'll whisper, "I'm sorry, master," and execute itself to provide you with the fires of life once more. Outside of the lack of fireball, I find the Wildfire Druid to be a fun choice, although you'll have to get real friendly with that spirit because half of your abilities require it to work. But if you don't want to play Pokemon with your druid, then you can always flavor it as just a ball of fire that you carry around, or a circle of flames that follows you. I'm just saying there's ways to depersonify it if you really want to. But that'll about do it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Be sure to leave a like, comment, subscribe, ring the bell so that you're always up to date on all your Dabby news, and maybe support me on Patreon so that I can get through the other 8 classes in this book. But yeah, Davy out.